Hello everybody, welcome to Arachne Loves It Retro. In this channel we will talk and review many retro games. As you surely know, today's game is Kid Icarus for the NES, as I call it. In this game Icarus falls into the underworld has to climb up, defeat Medusa and free Palutena, so he can roam the skies once again. So, how did Nintendo execute this ambitious idea? Well, I gotta say, pretty well, even if some persistent glitches can actively damage your experience. Those glitches are due to the fact that the game itself tries to do many things at once. You got vertical scrolling boards, horizontal, side-scrolling labyrinths, boss battles, and a shoot-em-up section. For 1986 and for the first Nintendo game that used 100% computer programming, unlike Super Mario Bros., it's pretty well held together. But what kind of graphical mistakes am I talking about? Pretty serious stuff, actually. In the vertical scrolling boards, Kid Icarus works just like Pac-Man. You have the chance to go to the left and right edges of the screen and come back on the opposite one. The game uses this to create mini and very easy to solve platforming puzzles in which you figure out how to continue going up. This feature is deactivated on every other kind of stage, but sometimes it triggers back up for a split second, just enough to create glitches such as enemies spawning into walls, suicidal monsters that forget AI behavior, duplicating enemies spawning on both sides of the screen, or fakeouts, where a monster can seem to be appearing left only to then go right. This can lead to hilarious or dangerous situations, to the point of causing your demise, depending how much you are low on health. Aside from that, they manage to avoid any game-breaking bugs and make the experience challenging all the same. The labyrinths in particular hold some real smart design and in composition that will get you overthinking every step. Apart from the last one, they're not really that hard to figure out, but since you don't have an actual map system, you can overcomplicate things for yourself. Pen and paper here will save you. You'll see how actually simple they really are. This is a good thing, since maps are really just a board that lights up the room you have already visited. An evolution of this labyrinth design is gonna be used in the first Zelda game, a year later. Anyway, the fact that every stage is not particularly hard is a good thing, since the enemies and some bosses can be a real pain. This makes the game good and balanced, since it would be a pain to have to deal with both hard platforming and hard encounters, because the platforming is a bit floaty and slippery. This does not apply to the entirety of stage 3, unfortunately. Here, enemy placements become really unfair and sometimes require previous knowledge of the stage for you to know how to overcome them. Some people like trial and error in platformers. For me, it depends on the game. This game and its extra game material didn't advertise platforming as Mario games did. This change in the third stage comes out of left field and serves no purpose. In fact, stage 4 is a single board and is a shoot 'em up. So the kind of skills that the previous one tries to teach you are immediately rendered useless. A pity. Like many non-RPGs on the NES, there is only a little bit of music. Although in this game, it's justified since like I said previously, the game throws really many ideas at you, so it's understandable. What is there though is pretty good, and the loops gain 15 or more seconds per loop compared to previous Nintendo games. Some tunes are really pretty good and memorable. They really try to squeeze everything they knew about game development in 1986, and that is commendable and appreciated. My final thoughts on Kid Icarus for the NES are that this game could have benefited from waiting until a more powerful hardware was out, like the SNES. The passion is clearly here, and the will to experiment and be different is supported by a really solid concept and foundation. I know that the Famicom Disk System version of this game is more solid and makes even better use of the hardware to avoid glitches and the slowdowns. I avoided talking about those because condemning slowdowns is basically the same as putting a negative spin on the entire NES library. So common that you can make that a negative? I don't want to be unfair in my judgment. The most important thing for me was to have fun, and I have to admit, I had quite a bit. Shooting your arrows in three different directions is pretty great, since the games at the time were really limited in how you could move and attack, and the responsive controls make up for many of the design frustrations. At the end, if I had to put it into words, I would say that Kid Icarus on the NES is very good, which for me, that I use the full scale in my reviews, translates to a solid 7 out of 10. Feel free to discuss this video, the review, and the channel in the comments section below. Hope you have fun on here. If you wanna see me play the retro games that I will review, hop on over to Arachne Plays It Retro. See ya at the next review!